Hello everybody, today I wanted to make a video about vector displacement. This is probably going to be a little bit on the longer side, so hopefully you'll stick with me. The first thing I wanted to show you is normal displacement, which most of you are probably familiar with. And this essentially can move points of a mesh along its normal direction. And it's great, but it does have limitations given that it can only move in one direction. A more powerful technique would be if we could move these vertex positions in any direction that we choose. And that's where vector displacement maps come in. So if we go over to my shading tab here, I have a cube set up with a vector displacement. And as we move our slider from 0 to 1, we can see that we've transformed our cube into a sphere. And we can go back into a cube. And anywhere in between. So this first part is going to be focused entirely on generating this data in Blender and some key considerations. The second video will be about using this data for real-time rendering in Unreal Engine. So let's go ahead and get into it. The first thing I wanted to talk about in Blender is how you generate the vector displacement map. And to do that, you need two key pieces of data, and that's the mesh or vertex position of your original geometry, which in this case I'm using a cube, and the vertex positions of your target geometry, which I'll be using a sphere. And the way that I achieved that in this case is with shape keys. So first we created a shape key for our original shape, and then we create a shape key for our desired shape. Just by clicking the plus sign on the shape keys here. Then you can go into that shape key, and I just went into mesh, transform to sphere, and created that. And then once you've done that, you can interpolate between the two, and you've got a shape key. But the shape key is not what we're trying to do. We're trying to get the same results as a shape key within the vertex shader. So the point of this exercise is to bake that data out into a texture so that it can be used in real time without having to rely on shape keys or morph targets as they would be in Unreal Engine. And in doing so, we open up the door to a lot of possibilities, like using this effect on static meshes or in particle systems, which wouldn't be possible with shape keys. So we know that we need to get the position of our mesh surface in its original and its desired position. We have our original and desired mesh created. The way that we would measure that and generate that data typically is through a texture coordinate node. So if we go into our shader, and we set up a texture coordinate. Again, that's Shift A, search, texture coordinate. And we're gonna take the object data and drag that to our material output. And that gives us something that looks like this. Then we are going to create a node for our image texture. So Shift A, image texture. And this image texture that we would create needs to be a 32-bit float because we want a high level of precision and we want to be able to store negative numbers so we can offset our vertices in any direction. Once we have our texture created, we can set up our bake. You'll want to be in cycles. You're going to go to the emit type, select your image, and then click bake. Once you've done that, you'll go to your second shape, which again, in this case, we're using a shape key, but you don't necessarily have to rely on a shape key. And then you would create a second image, once again, a 32-bit float, and you would bake that out. Once you have your two positions, again, these are essentially telling us what is the vertex position of our sphere and more specifically, it's telling us the surface position, not a vertex position, which is important. We'll talk more about that later. We would take those two points of data, and we would subtract our original shape, the cube, from our desired shape, the sphere. When we subtract these two positions from each other, it will give us a vector that is the direction and length of the difference between these two points in world space. And that vector looks like this. So we can see what's happening here. Essentially, areas that are blue are areas that need to be moved in the z-axis. Areas that are red need to be moved in the x-axis. Areas that are green are moved in the y-axis. And we can actually see this happening as we move between the shapes. And so this image allows us to get any direction of displacement, as opposed to that traditional displacement map, which is typically just a grayscale image. And that's why it can only go in one direction. If you want to be able to see this displacement on your material, you need to make sure that you go into your material, into the settings tab, and set displacement to displacement only. And then you would plug your subtract node into the vector displacement node. And at that point, you can begin to increase the scale. So that works pretty well. And you can see here that if we go back to our cube in edit mode, that this mesh is actually still a cube. It just appears as though it's a sphere because of the vector displacement. And so this is all happening in the vertex shader, which enables for very efficient displacement effects, especially for real-time rendering. But there is a problem with how traditional vector displacement maps like this work. As I mentioned earlier, the positional data that you're saving is not the vertex position, but it's a position on the surface of a mesh. So, for example, as we zoom into this here, each pixel doesn't necessarily represent a vertex in space. It represents a part of the mesh on in world space. And what ends up happening is, as we move around this, and this will be easier if I switch over to a different material and maybe get rid of the wireframe, you can actually see that there are seams in the displacement because it sampled a point on the surface of one section of our mesh and not the vertex, and then it sampled a comparable position on a different part of the mesh, which would be over here in this case. And those two points, because they didn't exactly line up with the vertex, it's creating a gap. And this is a problem that I wanted to set out to solve. And in this video, I'm going to be giving you a solution to how you can fix this problem. But there are some caveats. So this particular version of the technique, the traditional vector displacement map, is good if you are creating a surface that the face data matters. You need to know about the position of every point on the face of your mesh, not just the position of your vertex. An example of this would be a stencil for use in ZBrush for sculpting, for example. You can't just rely on the vertex position because you don't necessarily know that your source and your target geometry have the same number of vertices, for example. But for a real-time shape key application like this, we actually do know that our source and our target geometry have the same the same numbers of vertices that we're displacing. So we're actually not interested in the face data at all. So rather than taking the bakes of the position directly from cycles, we can instead store the vertex positions directly into an image. Since I'm not a programmer, I reached out to the Blender community over on Stack Exchange, and with the help of another user there, we were able to create a Python script that met my conditions, and I'll be linking to that post in the description in case anybody wants to check that out. If you find it useful, be sure to upvote that user's contribution. So if we go ahead and I just want to demonstrate this here. If we take my version of vector displacement using this different technique based around the vertex position and not the surface position, you can see that we actually eliminated the seams of the mesh. So again, here is the original with seams, and here is the pixel perfect version. And what we can also do here is overlay our target shape. So I've got another sphere that's the exact same shape. And with the technique that I designed, and it's probably not a completely original technique, it's based on concepts that exist, but I couldn't find any information about this already existing, so I really wanted to get this information out there and available. You can see that they overlap perfectly, and if we go to the traditional vector displacement, you can see that in certain areas, the displaced mesh sticks out too far, it has seams. Other places where we're seeing the white sphere, it is not displaced far enough. So ultimately, the result is really not good. The higher the resolution your mesh is, your texture is, the closer to accurate your results will be, because the closer a pixel will be to the vertex. But if you're trying to render this data in real time, Float 32 images are expensive. And again, when you create these, you really need to be using Float 32 so that you can save negative values to read. And that means 32 bits per channel. It's extremely expensive data-wise to create a high resolution texture. So the other condition of my method is designed around reducing the texture memory cost. And because all we care about is the vertex data, the way that we can both improve the accuracy of our displacement and reduce the memory cost is by only evaluating the vertex positions and completely throwing away the data that exists on the face. And that looks like this. So what you're seeing here looks a little crazy because the vertex positions are being colored accurately, but all of the data in between is being interpolated from a second UV map. The actual image itself looks like this. And this is a 19 by 20 image versus a 1024 by 1024 image. So we've reduced the size of our image significantly and the memory cost massively with this change, and we've actually achieved a better displacement result in the process. So let's go ahead and talk about how this is achieved and talk about the script itself. So we're going to go over to the scripting tab. And I've already got this script pasted in here. And there's a couple of things that I wanted to talk to you about it. First, in order to run the script, you need to make sure that you have an object selected. And then next, you want to go ahead and select the shape key that you are trying to save as an image. And what this script is going to do is it's going to run through your mesh and store each vertex as an RGB value, a float 32, and write that to a pixel on a texture and it's also going to create a UV map, and it's going to align that UV with that texture. There are two options set up in this version. One, to have your image be as long as there are pixels, and then one row tall. But we also included a version here that will give you a roughly square image, and you could modify this to get a perfectly square image if you wanted to. But what it's going to do in the way that we have it configured here, we've just uncommented the section to get the square image, is it will bake all this data out for us without having to rely on cycles and arrange our UVs. And you'll see here, if we were to run this script, it would create a UV map that is named after your shape key dot UV, and it would generate a texture based off of your shape key named your shape key dot texture. The UV map, if we go over into our UV editor, it looks like this. And this looks pretty crazy, but the reason it looks like this is, again, because each point on our mesh, we want to represent just one vertex position. So you can see that that is exactly what we have here. It doesn't matter that the faces are overlapping, because we aren't interested in the data that's interpolated over the face. We only care about the exact vertex position. So if we go over now to our shading once again, I've got this set up here. If we go into our image dropdown, we've got a basis texture and a target texture. And again, these are absolutely tiny. And the math is the same, right? We are just taking our basis and subtracting that from our target. Make sure that you have set your alternate UV map here. And then when you run your vector displacement, you'll get pixel perfect results on these vertex positions. From here, you can save these textures out. So you would go into here, and then image, and then you would select save. And then you want to make sure that when you save it to a file that is going to maintain that accuracy, regardless of which method you use. Personally, I would suggest using OpenEXR and maintaining that in full. You could also modify the script. As it currently stands, again, it is giving you the vertex position, and therefore you need two images, and you subtract them from each other. But in reality, what we really care about is the difference between those two points. So you could also just save the difference between those two points. That would require some modifications of the script. I just wanted to keep things simple for this video and do the subtraction in the shader. But when we take this data over into Unreal Engine, I will be actually subtracting these against each other in Photoshop to create one singular texture, so that we only need one texture lookup. But this is pretty much all there is to it on the Blender side. From here, you could go ahead and export your mesh as an FBX and save out your textures as OpenEXRs. And you might also, at this point, consider generating a normal map as well. And we'll talk more about that in the next video. No, this was a long one, but if you're interested in learning on Unreal Engine 5 or 4, how to use this information in real time, be sure to check that out, and thanks for watching.